I'm taking a tip from Keith over at Turn Right Machine Works on YouTube. If you don't subscribe to him, do so. This is Never Seas. It's and this one says Mariner's Choice. They have different varieties of it. I think it's all the same stuff, but it's like cold peanut butter and kind of like pipe putty. And you put it on bolts and nuts, according to this, to keep them from seizing up under temperature, salt water, corrosion, high heat. But Keith recommends it for surfaces, too, and I'm doing that. So I'm putting my, I took my winch back apart because I got this tip from him after I had this thing together. So we've taken the winch back apart, and we're coating all the surfaces that I had trouble getting apart the first time with this, and we'll... I'll let you know in 20 years when I do this again, how this works out.
As would be predicted by this model.
All right, another great tip we got from Keith is use, what is this stuff? Distilled white vinegar for cleaning up epoxy paint, and it works great. Takes it off your hands, takes it off parts that you get it on that you didn't want. And Kay told me something that she really appreciates about it. What is it? Kay, say it again.
It doesn't take off my fingernail polish.
Guys, like it won't take off your fingernail polish like acetone does, all right? So there you go. White vinegar.
Maybe down, Lori.
All in?
Yeah. See, these are seated right here.
Yeah.
We're done. We set the clutch back in. Kay says that's a trust exercise.
Got a real distinct feeling. I should have done that before I slid all these parts off of this when I was trying to disassemble it, because that had a lot of rust and crud on there. I think it's just because it's unprotected steel. It doesn't have anything to keep it from rusting up. Moving some of the damage I did with my hammer. Well, in all fairness, I did damage on top of damage somebody else had done. Another idea we stole from Keith. Just take a piece of steel rod and put a slit down it so you can slide some sandpaper in there. Works great. So here's the reason why I should have cleaned that shaft before taking this part off and banging on it so hard, is because I actually bent the little grooves in for the where the keys go, so that, that first 3/8 quarter inch there doesn't fit. So I've had to file them down so it works. So should have cleaned it first, taking it off with less force, but hard to teach that to a caveman. Okay, I'm glad I make videos, because I don't take notes when I take things apart. And so it's nice to go back and look at the pictures. But proper reassembly of this thing is a thick washer, bushing, thin washer, the gear for the worm drive, the Woodruff keys, I guess they're called, and the hub with the large side pointing that direction, because this, the recess points toward it. So the recess is here to go over this section, the extended section of the hub, skinny washer, bushing, fat washer. Okay, now these are the Woodruff key slots where my capstan's going to sit, and they hadn't been used for years, so they were all bent up right here on the edge, and I tried to file to scrape the edges down, and that worked a little bit. It got pretty good, but then I remembered I had some little cutoff wheels, and these are, I think I got them from Harbor Freight, probably 3-inch cutoff wheel and real thin. And they happen to fit onto one of my pneumatic tools, and you know, just run it down the edge. Cleaned it up real nice, and so now these fit beautifully. And so, you know, me being as cheap as I am, I need two more of these in the other end of the shaft that doesn't have them. So I know what you're thinking. You're thinking that don't do it. It won't work. And well, yeah, you may be right, but. If you're right, I'm gonna prove it one way or the other. And so if you're wrong and you're one of those machinists, then hey, you're gonna owe me a beer if this works. And if it doesn't, I'll buy you one. You swing by. That won't be I'll apologize for having gone this route. But I'm gonna give this thing a try, because you know me, I'm cheap. And if I can do something now, even though the machine shop is close by, it means well we can do it later on the boat when there's not a machine shop close by. And I'm certainly not going to have a mill in my cargo hold. Maybe a lathe, but not a mill. Well, there we go. Two Woodruff key slots cut in about an hour and a half. And I can see where this would not be something you want to do with a smaller key, because it's going to get, you know, the slop in it is going to be more critical. And the blades are going to have to be a lot smaller. These are 3-inch diameter keys. And, you know, I can't even find these things. I'm going to have to go to some specialty shops tomorrow, and I'll probably end up just making these myself out of some half-inch steel. Because they, once you get to buying something that's unique, they start getting pretty expensive. And I'm obviously cheap. So, just got to hold the drill in this. Actually, I got to refix this where they refix it. That's a word. I got to fix this where they use a torch on to cut something off there. I'm not sure what it is, but anyway, I'm going to fill that back in and grind it round with a grinder, because this will never fit into my lathe. So it's getting a lot of weld put back on it, and now some grinding. Well, the trick is to wedge this on there as hard as it would go, and you can feel where it rocks, so you know the two high spots, and then you can also see where it leaves some paint behind from this epoxy paint. And so after a while, you get it where it goes on. I don't want to force it on there on the stick. Yeah, that's good enough. It's not pretty, you know. Well, apparently these, which are Woodruff keys, and this happens to be what's considered a very large one, are hard to find. So I got a piece of steel in the lathe that is a little more than 7/16 inch wide. It's half inch plate, what it is. Welded a rod to it, and you can see that I can get 3 keys, I think, out of each of these. So I'm going to turn 2 of them down and make me some spares. Well, after giving it next to no thought, I just went ahead and put it in the bandsaw, and we'll slice the chunk off there. It'll be pretty close, and then we'll sand it down or grind it down to the right size. That's what happens when you cut a belt, huh? This is my belt sander. It's just cobbled together. I think I paid $20 for the belt rig. I think it's an old Sears Craftsman belt stand, and it just has a couple of screws on each end that tighten this roller by pushing it out. And it used to have pads on the rollers, and it's just got masking tape on it now, which works fine if the belt is thick enough. It didn't work well with thin belts. And I run either aluminum oxide or this zirconia type belt. And the zirconia is these belts. This is I think it's 6x45, and it costs like $12. And the other ones, the aluminum oxides, are half that price. But it's a great machine to have around the shop. This is kind of a low power version of this. I think I got a 2 horsepower motor on there. And it kind of does the job. You got to have a little bit of patience with it. 4 horsepower would be, you know, where I'd like to be with it. But that's not what was laying in the pile. And then the stand, I just cobbled together a stand out of some square tubing, put some wheels on it, and a handle on it to make it, moving it around the shop, a little easier. Power switch and a plug, so I can plug other junk in, because I often use my grinder around it too. And the way it works is the plate down here that the motor is bolted to is hinged at the back. And well, they're not really hinges, they're just this is a neat idea. You just weld a nut to the plate and a weld a nut to the stand, and then put a bolt through, and you got yourself a hinge, so you don't ever have to buy hinges. Same thing on the other side there. So this has its own weight holding the tension on the belt. So it's really easy to get the belt off. You just, you know, roll it off like that, let the motor drop. And then the stand is it's hinged on one side. It's almost cut all the way through. So it lifts up like that. And then you can loosen the belt and pull it off. But you got to watch the belt movement, because as the belt moves, it cuts into the ears. And you can see it's got a little bit more. And I'm going to have to put some weld in there to reinforce these, because you got to watch the belt walk. And you get the belt hot on one side, it will creep one way and then the other, so it's kind of nice. I put some little handles on this because they were just for a wrench to make it where I could just reach down and turn them easily if need be. And I don't use the jam nut on it because as the temperatures change on the thing, the belt will want to walk one way or the other. So it's not the greatest rig probably, but good thing to have around for $20 as a starter, and $6 to $12 belts, and I think the motor was $25 that came off a vacuum pump that went tits up. So not too much money invested in the thing, so I'm real happy with that.